So goodness, passion and ignorance based on the teachings of His Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. This is text 5 of the 14th chapter. Material nature consists of three modes: goodness, passion and ignorance. When the living entity comes in contact with nature, he becomes conditioned by these modes. In the spiritual world, in our original state, we are not under the grip or the clutches of these modes. Goodness, passion and ignorance, in Sanskrit it is also called sattva-guna, rajah-guna and tamah-guna. So when the living entity comes in contact with this material world, material nature, prakriti, he gets conditioned, he gets influenced. He loses his original individuality in the sense, and he gets, so to say, goaded by the type of modes influencing him. If it is rajah-guna which is predominantly influencing him, he acts in a particular way. If it is rajah-guna, he acts in another way. So we'll see that as we move forward. So the living entity is under the spell, just like bolte na jadoo kar diya us pe, and the person starts behaving, black magic ho gaya us pe. He starts behaving in a weird way. Kya kar diya us pe? So under the spell of the modes. Now, this is a very good example. How all of us have different natures, different inclinations, different likes, different dislikes. Even in a family, somebody likes eating a particular vegetable, another person does not like. Someone likes fruit, someone doesn't like. Do we see that characteristic difference? Even in a family, somebody likes rock music, somebody likes pop music, somebody likes classical music. Different kinds of tastes are there. What is nectar for one person is poison for another. When I was in a college, we were three of us sharing one room, and one of my friend, we were sharing the room, he was from Mumbai. REC, you know, it has students from all states. So he was a great fan of rock music. And I have no clue, no idea, no inclination whatsoever of rock music. And in hostel, when you come, you have the freedom, you can play the music the way you want. So he made a, you know, some makeshift sound system with that, you know, you have that matkas, you put the speaker inverted and, you know. So he made that and he would really start playing that heavy metal. Anyone has heard of heavy metal? I mean, sometimes you wonder how it is called music. What is there to appreciate? But there are people who are so fond of it. So how people have so much varieties of taste? For example, now classical music, not everyone likes it. Somehow I'm not a good fan, I don't have taste much for music. And many times we have these cultural programs in Bangalore, and then tha, thi, tha, thi, thi, tha. So it doesn't make any sense to me. Sometimes I wonder why, again, with all due respects, I know that I don't have a taste, but sometimes I wonder why are they wasting time? If they have to depict something, let them tell what is happening and at least we can understand what's happening, but a dance is going on and then, you know, the whole lot. But there's a great science. People are not wasting their time. So how these different tastes are there? Why there is so much variety in this world? people with different inclinations, people with different likes, even the same family. Sometimes children are there, they pester that I want to eat this. Parents, no, it's not good. No, you should not eat it. We know that it is wrong, but still, you cannot avoid. He has that like, he has that taste. So here we have an example that how all the colors what we see printed in different ways, let's say in the form of calendars, brochures, different kinds of leaflets, they all are printed using only four colors. We discussed in the last session, CMYK, cyan, magenta, black and yellow. Now you see the picture here, it has colorful fruits, different kinds of colors are there, yellow, red, green, purple, all that. All this picture is actually made of these four colors only. In fact, when this is called color separations, plates are made. Some of you may be familiar with the printing technology. Plates are made, and when the paper passes through a roller, only blue ink gets imprinted, so to say, on the paper. And the paper, this picture what is getting printed will look something like this if you were to remove that paper at that stage from the printing machine. Then it passes through another roller, the magenta, the red color thing gets printed. And then we have yellow, black. When all these things are looked together, it appears colorful. Now this is how it is actually. This is the picture printed. If you see this picture under a lens, magnify the picture, you will see actually a lot of grains. Have you noticed that? These just technology has improved. You actually don't see the grains because the number of DPIs, dots per square inch, 300 DPI. Because the dots are so closely printed, so finely printed, that we don't see the dots. And actually, if you magnify further, you see this face, this part of the face, this eye is nothing but dots of CMYK. Cyan, magenta, yellow, and black. Now, the density of dots and the thickness of the dots, that determines different colors. For example, now here it looks little blackish. So here you have K dots, that is black dots, little more in number and little more bigger in size. Another example. Now this is this aspect, if it is blown up, this is blue color. You see the blue dots are more in number and these four dots are there, but depending on the size of the dot, how closely they are packed, different colors manifest. Now why I am sharing this with you? I'm not trying to teach printing or share more about what is happening in printing industry. Just like with four colors, you can have unlimited shades of colors. Likewise, the influence of these three modes on our consciousness can create so many varieties of tastes, inclinations, desires, initiatives. Just like you have yellow. In yellow, you have hundreds of yellow shades. In blue, you have hundreds of blue shades. Likewise, predominantly, somebody may be in sattva-guna, but in that also there is variety. Broadly speaking, it is sattva-guna, rajah-guna, and tamah-guna. But with these combinations, 80% sattva guna, 16% of rajah guna and 4% of tamah guna, the behavior, inclination, taste is one thing. You change the percentage, you have another variation. Now, these modes are influencing us. There's a spell on us. Just like these colors, when printed on the paper, leaves a different color impression. The paper looks green, the paper looks bluish. Likewise, these modes, when they influence us, impact our thinking, feeling, willing, our actions, our desires, our inclinations, everything. Now, this is another similar example, just to take you further on what we discussed. Now, you see, this is yellow. This image drawn in yellow. Now, this image is yellow plus magenta. It is looking a little orangish. So, when the paper passes through these two rollers, it will look something like this. And then we have the third roller, which is blue color. The image looks something like this. And then it passes through a black roller, it looks something like this. So this image is drawn in yellow, magenta, and cyan, like that. So these modes, which are influencing us, depending on which mode is predominant. Now, a question to all of you. A picture is static. You know, I see a picture, it is yellowish, or it is bluish. Is the mode which is influencing us, the percentage of sattva guna, tamo guna, rajo guna, is it static? Is it fixed? Yes, no. How many of us say it is fixed? Based on our birth, based on which family, which caste we have taken birth, it's fixed. How many of us say it's fixed? How many of us say it varies? The influence of the mode varies. The influence of the mode we'll cover in the next few verses. It is very dynamic. In the morning time, which mode is predominantly influencing us? Sattva guna. As time passes, as the day passes, it's rajoguna which becomes predominant. In general. Some people will be rajasic throughout the day, possible. Or tamasic throughout the day, possible. Kumbhakarna, 6 months. So, by and large, morning time is predominantly sattva guna, day time predominantly is rajoguna, and as the sun sets, darkness, night, it's tamoguna which sets in. That's why you will see everywhere, temples open early in the morning. Bars and pubs open late in the evening. You don't have anybody going to bar at 4:30 in the morning. You don't have people going to the temple. No doubt there are some busy temples. Generally, the temple darshan closes by 8:39. O sinless one, the mode of goodness, being purer than the others, is illuminating. And it frees one from sinful reaction. If we are under the influence of sattva guna, or mode of goodness, the symptom, the effect, the spell of that mode on us will be, it will be illuminating. We'll have knowledge. We'll be able to see things relatively more clearer. See things as they are, relatively speaking, compared to the influence of other modes. And it frees one from sinful reactions. Other modes are very entangling. If suppose somebody is in tamoguna or rajoguna, he is goaded, he is forced, he is impelled to act sinfully. And gets entangled. Those situated in modes, in that mode, that is mode of goodness, develop knowledge. But they become conditioned by the concept of happiness. There's a danger of even mode of goodness. We'll talk about it as we move forward. Although it is better than rajoguna and tamoguna, but still there is a danger. The living entities conditioned by material nature are of various types. That's how we have 4 lakh species. Out of 84 lakhs, 4 lakhs species, different types. It is based on the influence of these modes. The effect of developing the mode of goodness in the material world is that one becomes wiser than those otherwise conditioned. So who is among the three, who is the wisest? Sattva-guna, Rajoguna, and Tamoguna. Who is the wisest? Sattva-guna. Who is influenced by Sattva-guna? Next. Rajoguna. Next. Tamoguna. A man in mode of goodness is not so much affected by material miseries as he has a sense of advancement in material knowledge. So he is in knowledge. He is under the influence of Sattva-guna. He is relatively regulated. He has less greed, hankering, bombarded with various desires. Relatively, that element is subdued. One is more or less free from sinful reactions. His life is simple, simple living, high thinking. That becomes this mode of living. He will eat sattvic food. The lifestyle will be good, do good. Do not unnecessarily trouble others. That is his mindset for a person who is predominantly in sattva-guna. In the Vedic literature, it is said that the mode of goodness means greater knowledge and greater sense of happiness. Compared to other modes, there's a greater sense of happiness. Sometimes people think, especially those who are in passion, they think happiness means, you know, when people dance also, you know, you have to really squeeze out happiness. Actually, to enjoy life also requires very fine intelligence. Sometimes people think that spirituality means, or spiritual, those who are practicing spirituality or spiritualist means, they have rejected happiness. Or they are against happiness. What's wrong? They say, what's wrong in enjoying life? What's wrong? Have you gone mad? What's wrong? In fact, a pure spiritualist also will think, what's wrong? What is day for a materialist is a night for a spiritualist. What is night for a materialist is a day for a spiritualist. So even the spiritualist is enjoying happiness, but a different kind of happiness. And in fact, in passion, a person who is in Rajoguna, he thinks that he is happy, but that very happiness actually is very entangling. It's illusory. It's momentary. It's fleeting. It is not satisfying. It brings in more and more hankering, more and more desires, triggers more and more desires. The difficulty is that when the person is situated in mode of goodness, he has a sense of well-being, a sense of satisfaction, sense of I am now very peacefully and nicely situated. And hence a person can get carried away. Can anyone help me with an answer? What's wrong if a person has a sense of satisfaction? Okay, I am very happy now. He is simple living, high thinking. He is morally, ethically upright. He doesn't trouble anyone. He does his job very ethically. What's wrong with that kind of a mindset? If one thinks that that is what life is, what's wrong? Anybody else? I think I'll repeat the answer. Yes. What's wrong? If suppose somebody thinks that I am happy, he eats very simple food, so health is good. He is not very passionate. He has simple life. He is not, you know, wanting this, wanting that. Ye bhi karna, ye bhi karna, ye bhi karna. He is satisfied, contented. What's wrong? But he is not at all striving for purifying his consciousness, trying to develop love for the Lord, develop a relationship with the Lord, engage in activities of devotion. He is not interested. What's wrong with that kind of a person? In fact, we will meet a lot of people who say, I don't go to the temple. I have seen many people who go to the temple, but they are maha. I don't trouble anyone. I help within my means, whatever possible. What's the use of going to the temple? See that person? So there are people who say that, yes, I don't trouble anyone, I help others, main anath chal chal raha hu, main ye bhi karta hu, donation bhi karta hu, mara wo bhi camp ho raha hai. I don't believe in God. What's wrong with that kind of an understanding or a mindset? No, I'm talking about a different scenario. A person who is young, you know, doing well in his business, he is living a simple lifestyle. And he has a satisfaction, has a sense of contentment. What's wrong with that kind of a mindset? Prakash ji, would you like to contribute? Because so the purpose of this world is not to settle down peacefully here. This world is not designed for that purpose. That's why all our attempts to settle down peacefully gets frustrated. Yes or no? We make attempts to settle down, to have permanence, to have permanent relationships, to have good health always. The world is not designed like that. It is not meant for that. A toilet is not meant where you can go down and settle down comfortably. It's meant for you to do something and come out. Finish your business and come out. So this world is designed for a purpose. And the purpose is that we have messed up our life, completely forgetful of our relationship with the Lord. And this creation is made where an opportunity is given for a person to revive that relationship. Bahunam janmanam ante gyanvan mam prapadyante vasudevam sarvamiti samhatma durlaba. So person who is in goodness can miss that point. He can try to settle down peacefully in a place which is not meant to settle down peacefully, not designed to settle down peacefully. He is not absolved of the real challenges or real problems of material existence with his janma, mrityu, jara, vyadi. He is not absolved of. A person, let's say, is a philosopher, he's a scientist, he's very knowledgeable, he's not into all this socializing, drinking, boozing. He's simple lifestyle. He is completely absorbed in his work. He is not passionate, he is just minding his own business. But he can miss the main point. So that's the danger. Now, a person may be so focused in riding smoothly. Let's say we have a car and a person is so focused that he should not meet with an accident, he should not violate any traffic law, and is driving so smoothly. But he can forget the destination. He can go in circles. You're driving for a purpose, to go from point A to point B. What is the point in just driving, having a smooth ride, and not going to the destination? So that can happen in mode of goodness. Due to illusion of material energy, one thinks that sort of life is pleasant. I am happy. I am contented. So example is given, if mode of ignorance is compared to an iron chain, passion is compared to a silver chain, goodness is compared to a gold chain. Chain is a chain. If a person is bound, doesn't matter what is the chain which is binding him. So sattva-guna is, relatively speaking, a costlier chain, a better chain, a more expensive chain, but it is still entangling. The mode of passion is born of unlimited desires and longings, O son of Kunti, and because of this, one is bound to material fruitive activities. Now we see a lot of passion, ye bhi karna, 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 so many desires. It's because of mode of passion. Unbounded desires. It goads a person, never satisfied. And because of this, one is bound to material fruitive activities. He entangles himself in innumerable material activities. Actually, you know, we all have to work. No one can sit idle. It's not recommended also. We all have to earn money. For that, we have to get educated. But it's a means to an end. When a person is in ignorance and passion, that means becomes an means become an end. That's a danger. For a person who is very passionate, the means become an end. The mode of passion is characterized by intense attraction between man and woman. So passion incites lust. For sense gratification, a man in the mode of passion wants honor in the society and wants to have a happy family with nice children, wife, house. He wants to make nice arrangements. Palatial house, good social circle, people will come, will glorify. Wow. They may not say, but then that appreciation, he's hankering for that. When the mode of passion is increased, one develops hankering for material enjoyment. He wants to enjoy sense gratification. I had gone last 2 days somewhere, a person whom we are supposed to meet for some reason, he has constructed a house for 200 crores. A house, 200 crores. And he was explaining what all amenities are there. I talked about Akshay Patra kitchen, we have a dumb elevator. Haan, mere ghar mein bhi hai. Wo cook khana banata hai and he presses a button, the right in 3 seconds that roti comes up on the dining table. So there's a system for that. He works hard, gets attached to the results of his work, gets bound and entangled. So all of us have heard of this this famous, we've heard in different places. So we all are, actually there's a template in our mind. We are hoping for enjoyment. What is the second stage after we hope? We chase. Just like here we have, there's a hope that I will get this carrot and it's running, chasing. Then what happens? Next stage. Hoping, chasing, then capture. You get it. And fourth stage is indulge. You try to indulge in it. And fifth stage is fulfillment. The nature of material enjoyment is predominantly a lot of time gets spent in these four stages. And fulfillment is very, very fleeting, very, very temporary. It doesn't satisfy. That's how when we get something, suddenly we have 10 more desires which are triggered. Hoping, chasing, capturing, indulging, and then fulfillment. Because that fulfillment is missing, constantly we are hoping, desiring, chasing, the life becomes a chase. Intense desires, always wanting more, more, more and more, hoping that if I get all this, I'll get fulfilled. But fulfillment, real fulfillment is missing. Modern civilization is considered to be advanced in the standard of mode of passion. It's present civilization is extremely passionate. There's a lot of passion in the air. You see how technology is changing. You have a model of phone next year. In fact, what the world has changed in the last 5 years, it has not happened in the last century. Our scriptures say, dharmasya hi apavargasya. We all have heard of pavarga. Pavarga in pa, pha, bha, bha, ma. Each of this word represents something. Dharmasya hi, what is dharma? What is true religious principles? What are they trying to achieve? Dharmasya hi apavargasya. Apavarga means it's nullify, negates pavarga. What is pavarga? Pa means, anyone can help me with an answer. Pa means what? Parishram. Intense hard work. You see, characterized by in today's world, intense hard work. There was a lady who was regularly attending our Gita Live session, very regular. Both husband, wife, I don't want to name now. And for the last 4 months, she has not been coming. So I asked her, I spoke to her, I said, you have been sometimes, you know, there could be different reasons. So I asked her, I don't see you now, last 4-5 months, you have not been regularly coming. So she says, Prabhuji, I go to the office at 8 a.m. in the morning, come back at 11 p.m. It's a 16 hours, 14 hours becomes the norm. The whole culture in the organization is like that. The boss stays there and he expects all his subordinates also to be there in the office. Then she says, even on Saturday we have to go. And she's really, he says, whole work-life balance, everything has gone for a toss. He says, I'm looking for a change. So parishrama, pa. Pa means what? Fena. Fena means froth. When a horse, when it runs, you know, it there's a froth in the mouth. Yes or no? Have you seen that? So, first stands for fena. Fena means froth. When you work very hard, you get so stressed out, you actually start foaming. May not be figuratively. Fena means, you know, you high blood pressure, tension, anxiety, completely out of balance. Pa. Ba means ba. Bandhan, you're right. Bandhan, a person becomes entangled. Bha, bhaya, fear. Person is working hard, but there's an insecurity, there's anxiety. And ma stands for mrityu. This pa, pha, bha, bha, ma characterizes our life. Intense hard work, parishrama. Then we have fena, we froth, anxiety, stress, hypertension, blood pressure. And then we have ba, bandhan, entangled. That very activity which is meant to give us pleasure, satisfy us, entangles us. Bhaya, always fearful. And ma, we lead that life and that ends in ma, mrityu. So what is dharma? Dharma hi apavargasya, that which negates this materialistic life of pavarga. dharmasya hi apavargasya, that which negates pavarga. Can go from now, those who are very passionate, intense desire, always longing, wanting more and more, never satisfied, never contented. Pa, pa, ba, ba, ma. For their sense gratification, for their materialistic goals, they may go from one part of the world to another. But when you ask them to come for Gita life, kya fayda hai? Mujhe kya milega? That is the mode of passion influencing. For materialistic goal, very, very fired up, very triggered, can do anything, can move the mountains. But when you say, ke, hear this thing, kya fayda hai? It's a waste of time. Kya milega mujhe? What will I get? O son of Bharata, the mode of ignorance causes the delusion of all living entities. The result of this mode is madness, indolence, and sleep, which binds the conditioned soul. See, Bhagavad Gita is so scientific. It is saying there are 84 lakh species. In that we have human species, 4 lakh consciousness. Why these 4 lakh gradations are there? Based on the modes which are influencing us. Just like CMYK, 4 colors, different percentage of these colors result in different shades of colors. Likewise, the influence of these modes are influencing our thinking, feeling and willing, our desires, our inclinations, our actions, our lifestyle, what we like eating, what we like speaking. It's all influenced by the modes. And human form of life is meant for, it's meant for, anyone can help me with this? Spiritual, real advancement is one elevates from the influence of lower modes to higher modes and crosses over the influence of these modes. Come to Shuddha Sattva. Because these modes are the one which is forcing us to act. In one sense, we are under a spell. We are helpless. Many times we know ki mujhe nahi karna, mujhe pata hai nahi karna, mujhe pata hai ye nahi khana. Lot of people do dieting for their thing, but they know, theoretically they know, this is not good for me, this is not good for my health. But still, this is a spell. You are forced. Prakrte kriyamanani gunai karmani sarvashaha ahankara vimudatma kartaham iti manyate. These modes are the ones which are actually forcing us to do different things. Kriyamanani gunai karmani sarvashaha. These gunas are doing karmana sarvashaha ahankara vimudatma. Vimuda means foolish. Ahankara, out of false ego. He thinks, I am doer, I am free. We are not free. First, we are under the spell of mode, just like that katputli, that puppets. The modes are influencing us, and based on the influence of the modes, we are helplessly acting. O son of Bharata, the mode of ignorance causes delusion of living entity. Delusion means he has no idea who he is. What's the purpose of existence? Everyone under the spell of mode of ignorance becomes mad. And madman cannot understand what is what. I heard this. This is a real life story. It's from a Mumbai. Something happened in Mumbai. There was a couple. A boy and a girl, they got to know each other in college, and there was an affair, and then eventually, with great difficulty, in spite of family members not agreeing, they got married. And initial few years were very good, but later on, there was again influence of modes, different likings, different tastes, And then quarrel started and fight became quite intense, became quite often, quite regular. And one day, it so happened that there was a very, very bitter fight in the house between these two, this husband and wife. So much so that both were screaming. Both were screaming. And they had one child, just 4-year-old. And in that madness, both of them mad, practically out of anger, screaming at each other, not able to tolerate, not able to handle each other's tantrums, the husband actually from a 7th floor of their apartment, 7th floor building in the apartment, caught hold of the child. He said, "One word if you speak more. One word if you speak more." You know, it was like a challenge out of fit of madness. He says, "I'll throw this child away." Both were attached to that child. So caught, they were in a balcony, caught hold of the child, says, "One word if you speak more," you know, out of that challenge. And out of madness, you don't, he says, you know, lose sense. She again started screaming, and this husband, maybe out of ego and out of this challenge which he threw up, he actually dropped the son. Imagine 7th floor, the son dropped. Because he had challenged the wife and she's screaming and he's screaming, both are getting mad, dropped the child and the child dropped dead. This wife rushed out of the building because, you know, child rushed out of the building, and by the time she reached the ground floor, she saw two dead bodies. One of the child and the second one of the husband. When he realized what he has done, he also jumped. And the sad part is, this was an article in Mumbai. This has happened in the real life instance. An old man sitting across in his balcony, the building, adjacent building, he saw this happening with his eyes. He got a cardiac arrest. He also collapsed. In a span of 3 minutes, 3 people died. And imagine what is going to happen to the wife. So this is the influence of mood. Cannot tolerate. Many times, as I said earlier, we blame circumstances, we blame people. But seldom we are thoughtful enough to understand, where am I going wrong? What can I do about a situation? It could be the modes which are influencing me. Instead of making advancement, one becomes degraded. Under the spell of ignorance, one cannot understand things as they are. Prabhupada gives this very nice example. It is a very striking example. Can anyone help me? What does this picture convey? Because sometimes the picture conveys hundreds of words. What does this picture convey? Camel eating thorns. Okay. So why all of a sudden I am showing this picture to you all? I could have shown a goat eating a grass, or maybe a tiger eating a lamb. Why this picture? Enjoying. Okay. By chewing, the tongue gets cut. Okay. Good, good, good. Good answer. So camel, actually in a desert, all what it can get is, you know, dry thorns. You don't get green grass and this thing. So camel actually chews those thorns, dry thorns. Imagine thorns which have got completely dried. Where is the juice in that? Where is the taste in that? And when actually chews the thorn, what happens is thorns actually prick the inner parts of his, the gums, the mouth, and the blood oozes out. And it keeps chewing, 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 and actually it relishes the taste of the thorn, which is nothing but its own blood.
So actually, a person who is in passion and ignorance, there is some similarity to this thing. May not be our own blood. The happiness what we experience is the cost of our own blood. It's our own happiness which we have pasted on something and work hard to achieve that, thinking that now I am happy. But actually, it's at the price of one's own blood. In their madness, they are very reluctant to make advancement in spiritual understanding. This explains why not everyone is inclined. Not everyone has a taste. Not everyone has taste for finer things. Another symptom of one embedded in the mode of ignorance is that he sleeps more than required. This is a symptom of tamoguna. Eight hours, 10 hours, 12 hours, and a person wakes up after 12 hours, I've conquered Mount Everest. Really done it. This is enjoyment. Whereas a person knows that sleeping is very important. It is a bodily requirement. As much as is required, knowing that actually I'm wasting precious time. But because the body requires. So whatever is required, minimum for body to be healthy, I'll give it. That's why Krishna says one who eats too much or eats too little, sleeps too much or does not sleep enough cannot be a yogi. Actually, it's a waste of time. But because it is required by the body for us to function properly, for the brain to function properly, as much as is required, I do it. The mode of goodness conditions one to happiness. Passion conditions him to the fruits of action and ignorance to madness. So predominantly how these three modes are influencing, it conditions one to happiness, to madness, and to fruits of action, gets very attached. A person in the mode of goodness is satisfied by his work and intellectual pursuits. He is contented. He is in his own world. A man in mode of passion may be engaged in fruitive activity. He owns as much as he can and spends for good causes. Sometimes he tries to open hospitals, give to charity, institutions, etc. Again, relatively speaking, it is better. In the mode of ignorance, whatever one does is neither good for him nor for anyone.